The Hounds of the Baskervilles by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. My friend Sherlock Holmes and I have been involved in some very strange cases of detection, but never one as strange as the one I'm about to tell. It began, ordinary enough, one late September, at his Baker Street flat in London. Holmes had in his hand a yellow faded document of some age, for it was dated Baskerville Hall, 1742. Holmes told me that it had been left for him by James Mortimer. "Like you, Watson, he's a doctor," said Holmes, "and he's calling on me in person later this morning." The yellow parchment told a fantastic story of the Baskerville curse and how it had begun. Long, long ago, on the edge of the Devon Moors, Baskerville Hall was owned by Sir Hugo Baskerville, a cruel and evil man. Sir Hugo had taken fancy to a farm girl across the moor. One night, when the girl's father and brothers were out hunting, Sir Hugo and a few of his friends kidnapped the girl, took her back to Baskerville Hall, and locked her in an upstairs room. Singing and shouting from the halls below terrified her. She opened the window, climbed down the ivy on the walls, and raced across the moonlit moors towards her home. When Sir Hugo had found that the girl had escaped, he was filled with rage and swore that he would give his body and soul to the powers of evil if he could recapture the maid. And his drunken followers shrunk from it in horror. Sir Hugo rushed to the stables, set loose his pack of hounds, and galloped wildly after the girl. After some time, his friends found their courage once more. Some of them chased after Sir Hugo, hoping that they would be in time to save the girl. They hadn't gone far when they came across a night shepherd. The man was almost too scared to speak, but he told them,
"Hugo Baskerville just passed me on his mare. Behind him ran an enormous black hound."
On they went. Soon they heard the sound of galloping, and Sir Hugo's mare came alone out of the fog, its mouth dabbled with froth, and its saddle empty. Now they rode close together, for a great fear was on them. At the edge of a clearing, they found the hounds huddled together, shivering like frightened dogs. In the middle of the clearing lay the dead body of the girl. Lying near her was Sir Hugo, and over him stood a massive black beast. As the horseman watched, it tore the throat out of its victim, then turned its blazing eyes and dripping jaws on them. They turned and fled, shrieking across the moors. Ever since that night, the Baskerville curse has passed from father to son. Many have died violent and mysterious deaths, and those who are to come are warned never to cross the moors in those dark hours when the devil hound is about. Here, the document ended. When Dr. Mortimer arrived, Holmes gave back the manuscript and said that he did not concern himself with fairy tales.
But be patient, Mr. Holmes, said Dr. Mortimer. It is important that you know the contents of this document before I tell you the facts of the death of my friend, Sir Charles, just 3 months ago.
Dr. Mortimer went on to tell us that in the weeks leading up to Sir Charles's death, he'd been acting rather strangely. He would often ask Mortimer and Barrymore, the butler, if they had seen any strange creatures or heard the baying of a hound. Dr. Mortimer was concerned. In addition to Sir Charles's weak heart, it would seem he was suffering from mental health problems too. He had also become a man of habit. Every night, he would walk up to the moor gates, but he would never go any further. One night in June, Barrymore found Sir Charles's body near the moor gates.
I was sent for, continued Dr. Mortimer. I examined the body. There were no physical injuries, but the face was twisted with terror. He had died from heart failure.
He also told us that he had followed Sir Charles's footprint, and it had seemed that Sir Charles had started to walk on his toes.
Barrymore said that there were no marks around the body, but I saw some, about 50 yards on the grass, before they were destroyed by the steady rain, said Dr. Mortimer.
There was a sudden glint of interest in Holmes's eyes.
Were they footprints?
Yes.
A man's or a woman's?
Dr. Mortimer looked at us in a curious way, and his voice sank to a whisper as he said,
Mr. Holmes, they were the footprints of a gigantic hound.
These words, a shudder went through me.
What exactly have you come to see me about, Dr. Mortimer? Asked Holmes. I want you to advise me. In 1 hour, Sir Henry, the younger brother of Sir Charles, and the last of the Baskervilles, will be arriving in London from Canada. I want to know, is Dartmoor a safe place for a Baskerville?
Dr. Mortimer added that the only other Baskerville, Sir Roger, the older brother of Sir Charles, had died in Brazil of yellow fever some time ago.
My advice is that you bring him to see me later this afternoon. Just one more question, Dr. Mortimer. Several people reported having seen a hound on the moors before Sir Charles's death, but have any seen it since?
No, Mr. Holmes. When Dr. Mortimer had gone, I asked Holmes why Sir Charles had started to walk on his toes.
That was nonsense, Watson. He was running. Running for his life. But running from what? That's our question.
When Dr. Mortimer and Sir Henry returned, Holmes explained the curse to Sir Henry. Sir Henry listened, and when Holmes had finished, he said that there was no man on earth, no devil in hell, that could stop him from going to Baskerville Hall.
Good, said Holmes, firmly. The matter is settled, but Watson must go with you.
Dr. Mortimer, Sir Henry and I caught a taxi
to the station, got on the next train to Dartmoor. The journey was a pleasant one. We talked about everything, and I formed a great liking for both Sir Henry and Dr. Mortimer. Sir Henry was a mild-mannered man, medium build, aged about 35, with a soft Canadian accent. It was late when we reached the station. An open stagecoach awaited us to take us to Baskerville Hall. Once we were on the moors, I could feel the air was cold. The heavy fog over Grimpen Marsh was preceded by a fine mist that made the last wisps of light twinkle on the wet moss and puddles. Suddenly, the driver pointed with his whip and said, "Baskerville Hall." And there it stood, glimmering like a ghost in the distance.
We pulled up to the porch. Barrymore stepped out to greet us. Wearily, we followed him to the house. Inside the house, on all the poorly lit walls, hung paintings and portraits of the Baskerville family going back generations.
"Hey, it isn't very cheerful in here," joked Sir Henry.
We had a meal, then went straight to bed. I looked out of the bedroom window across the moors. It seemed cold, grey, very unfriendly, and I lay on my bed for some time before sleep came. The next morning, our spirits were much higher. Sir Henry and Dr. Mortimer had some business to attend to, so I decided to go for a walk. I had not gone far when I heard someone call my name. It was a man dressed in a white coat and a pair of long boots, aged between 30 to 40, and he was carrying a butterfly net. He introduced himself as Jack Stapleton. A friend of his, Dr. Mortimer, had told him about me. As we talked, a long sad moan crossed the moors. It turned me cold with terror. Stapleton's nerves seemed stronger than mine, for he said calmly, "It's a moor pony, stupid animal." I looked into the distance and watched its head twitch and roll for some time as it slowly sank into the mud. He continued, "It wanders off onto Grimpen Marsh and then gets trapped in the swampy mud and sinks. It's a terrible place, Grimpen Marsh. I've only lived here for 2 years, but I know my way through it to where the rare butterflies are. But take my advice and stay away from it." Stapleton began to ask me about Sir Henry. As he did, a dreadful noise swept the moors, like the sound of a wolf howling at the moon. This time, even Stapleton was bothered. "What was that?" I asked in terror. "They say it is the Hound of the Baskervilles calling for its prey. I've heard it before, but never so loud." After saying how he would love to meet Sir Henry, he invited myself and Sir Henry to supper. Then we said our goodbyes.
Then Stapleton walked quickly off towards his home on Grimpen Moors.
The death of the pony and the curious sound like a hound had upset me, and I returned to Baskerville Hall with my head full of vague fears. Sir Henry was pleased to see me, so I told him about Stapleton and how he had invited us to supper.